Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha and today's topic is papilla preservation flap. This flap technique was introduced by Takai et al. In the year 1985. Please note, this technique was modified in various forms, that is minimally invasive surgical techniques, by Cortellini et al. And Cortellini and Tonetti et al. This is an entirely different topic, that is minimally invasive surgical techniques, which is basically various modifications of this technique. Do let me know in the comment section below if you are interested in learning minimally invasive surgical techniques. For this video, we will learn papilla preservation flap. Before discussing the flap technique, let me clarify, there are types of flaps based on the papilla management. There is a different classification based on papilla management. That is, if you preserve the papilla, it's papilla preservation flap, and if you split the papilla, mind you, I'm not talking about splitting the papilla from its center, splitting the papilla just below the contact point of the teeth, that is into the buccal half and palatal or lingual half. So if the papilla is split just below the contact points of the teeth, then it is split papilla technique. But here, because the embrasures are wide, if you can appreciate from the drawings, there is interdental spacing, and here we have an opportunity to preserve the papilla, that is by not splitting them into their buccal halves and palatal or lingual halves respectively. So here, in such cases where there is interdental spacing, especially anterior regions for aesthetic purpose, where preservation of the maximum interdental tissue to maintain that interdental height post-operatively, post-healing, is our concern. So in such cases, especially anterior regions where there is interdental embrasure spacing which allows adequate or comfortable passage of the palatal portion of the interdental tissues, there this technique can be applied. So now let us begin with the technique. The technique begins with sulcular incisions, that is just sulcular. Just note where I am giving incisions. Okay, they are into the sulcus, not passing through the interdental papilla. We are not splitting the interdental papilla. We will discuss how we are managing the papilla by which incisions. We will discuss it. So the first incisions are sulcular incisions. Again, sulcular because we are preserving the maximum tissue. So we are not giving internal bevel incision in form of a submarginal level, because we are preserving the maximum tissue, especially anteriors, where we don't want any sort of, any scope of recession and sensitivity, because it is aesthetic zone. So our incisions are sulcular, that is within the sulcus. Similarly on the palatal aspect, the sulcular incisions. Okay. Now these papilla, which are the wide open spaces, that is the embrasures, here we give semilunar incisions, because we are preserving the papilla. This semilunar incision should dip apically by at least 5 mm, so that this papilla is easy to handle and can be pushed into the facial aspects covered with the facial flap or the labial flap. So now the incisions are complete. I repeat, the sulcular incisions on both the aspects, labial and palatal, and these interdental wide spacing is managed by semilunar incisions dipped apically by at least 5 mm, so that the tissue, the palatal papillary tissue, is manageable, easy to handle. Clear? Now the palatal incisions looks like these, that is these sulcular incisions connected via semilunar incisions. Now this papillary tissue is involved in the facial flap, which is reflected by full thickness flap elevation. And so now after full thickness flap elevation, the facial aspects looks like this. That is our incision and the papilla. Clear? So these are our papilla, which are undivided. Papilla are preserved. The facial half and the palatal half, which are both included into the facial flap for this technique. After this full thickness flap elevation and reflection, these flaps are involved in the facial aspects. Now this flap is held by a periosteal elevator, and the underlying the roots and the bone surface which is accessible now is debrided. The flap is held by a periosteal elevator. Clear? Holding this flap with the periosteal elevator, the underlying roots and the bone surface are curated. Clear? Scaling and root planing of the root surface is bone curettage if applicable. After the root surface and bone surfaces are found clean, the flaps are placed back to their original position. This is again another important step in this technique. The flaps are placed back, that is, they are placed and this palatal portion of the interdental papilla is pushed via these embrasures again back to their original position as before. So, once the flap is placed back to the original position, these interdental papillary tissue, that is the palatal portion of the papilla, is pushed back via these embrasures onto their original site. So, the post-operative site looks like this after placing the flap back to its original position. Here are our flaps closure meeting. This is where the sutures are given. Ideally, cross matrix sutures, alternatively, direct sutures are also given. This completes the technique, papilla preservation technique. Because here we have preserved the papilla. I repeat once again, flaps are divided into two types that are, they are classified based on the papilla management. If the papilla is split at this point, that is just below the contact point, that is they are split here into the buccal or labial half and the palatal or the lingual half, then they are called split papilla technique, which we have discussed till now. And today we are discussing papilla preservation flap where it is applicable, that is in open spaces, wide open spaces where it is not necessary to split the papilla. Rather, we can give our incision on the palatal aspects and involve the papillary palatal tissue on the facial aspects within the facial flap. These are the two types of technique, split papilla, that is split papilla flap, and papilla preservation flap. This is the basic concept behind papilla preservation flap. Okay. And this is what is done in this present technique. I repeat the technique, sulcular incisions on both labial and palatal aspects, followed by semilunar incisions on the palatal aspects to involve the palatal portion of the interdental papilla into the labial flap. The palatal papilla, the semilunar incisions have to be at least 5 mm apical so as to be able to handle the palatal portion of the interdental papilla. Now, after the full thickness flap elevation, the labial aspect of the operative site looks like this. That is, with the labial flap and the palatal portion of the interdental papilla included within. This flap is held with the periosteal elevator to get access to the underlying root and bone surfaces. Root surfaces are debrided, that is thorough scaling and root planing. Bone is altered only if applicable, that is in case of bone defects, that is regenerative procedure is performed, followed by the soft tissue curettage of the inner surface of the flaps. Please note, in the maxillary anterior region or mandibular anterior region where aesthetics are concerned, the inner surface of the flap is treated minimally so as to preserve the full thickness of the flap so as to avoid post-operative recession and sensitivity. Whereas otherwise, because we have given sulcular incisions, the inflamed pocket epithelium and connective tissue are now present on the inner surface of the flap, which has to be removed or eliminated by soft tissue curettage. That curettage is performed thoroughly otherwise, but if it is a region of aesthetic concern, the soft tissue curettage, that is of the inner surface of the flap, has to be minimum so as to preserve the maximum tissue and avoid the maximum chances of post-operative recession. After the hard tissue surface and soft tissue surface treatment are completed, the flaps are then placed back to their original position with the sutures. Occasionally, periodontal dressing is also provided and both the sutures and the periodontal dressing are removed after 1 week. This completes the technique, papilla preservation flap. Coming to the advantages, as you can definitely see, preservation of the interdental papilla, which is our prime concern whenever we perform any surgical technique. Preservation of the into the dental papilla. Minimum approach, the minimalistic approach, and hence the technique of choice in the anterior regions which are of aesthetic concern. This completes the topic papilla preservation flap. I hope the technique is clear to you all, but if you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or mail me at my email ID dentalstudiesimplified@gmail.com. Also, do let me know if you want me to discuss minimally invasive surgical techniques. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well, have a good day, stay safe.